whenever the band came under pressure, there would be maybe a walkout, a separation, a row.
Sometimes I feel I'm gonna break down and cry. Nowhere to go, nothing to do with my time. I get lonely, so lonely, living on my own.
I like Queen very much, but I mean, I don't want to end up living a quartet. I'm 37 years old, and I want to do something different, and it's about time I did, otherwise I'll get too damn old and I'll be in a wheelchair.
There was a lot of strain when Freddie did his solo album, mainly because the advance was actually considerably more than advances for Queen albums.
There is an inward jealousy, and they're all wondering and all waiting for us to see if say, my album's going to do better than the last Queen album or something like that. It's not easy, living on my own, my own. Sometimes it's nice to actually sort of break away from a group that's actually been going for so long, meaning staying away.
He was definitely contemplating the idea of what living on my own actually means, because, I mean, he lived in Munich for well over a year. When Freddie was alone in Munich, he had to basically fall back either on the gay community, or when he needed some sense or decent advice, he'd call us. He was hanging out a lot at our place. He'd spend a lot of time with the kids. It was nice, like a family affair. He said a lot of times that this was his best time in his life.
Out of the songs you put on this album, Freddie, which one do you find the most rewarding, personally?
Oh, I don't know. The one that sells the most.
Freddie had a very fulfilling experience of creativity, but he didn't have a very fulfilling experience, how shall I say, economically.
The Mr. Bad Guy album really was a disaster in terms of sales. The strength for Queen came from the arguments. It was the fact that you had to fight your space. Songs got fine-tuned by that. And Freddie working on his own in Munich with an orchestra and Mac, there was nobody really to stand up with him.
Well, tomorrow, the pop world's greatest extravaganza, as we've been talking all morning, Live Aid, will be bringing together rock's brightest and best from both sides of the Atlantic, and all performing for free in the hope of raising millions for the starving people of Africa.
You know, looking back, there was a moment when Queen were thought of as a good group that was predominantly historic. Radio Gaga was their one big hit in 4 years. They weren't on a hot streak. And they weren't a particularly productive group at that time. There was a feeling that maybe that was it. But Geldof ordered them to regroup and perform.
The thing was, did Fred want to do it? You know, because Fred wasn't that keen.
You know, I think Freddie was a bit reticent about doing anything. But Bob came in one day when we had talked about the Live Aid thing, and he said, I told Freddie he's doing it. And I kind of believe him.
It was rehearsed quite intensely at the Shaw Theatre on Euston Road.
Queen took the responsibility more professionally than anyone else on the bill.
I went out and bought these big plastic white clocks and put them sort of in the orchestra pit so we could see the time.
There was an 18-minute slot that each artist had, and there were traffic lights at the side of the stage, and you were warned when you walked on that the traffic lights, you know, after 16 minutes would turn amber from green. And he said, you won't see them turn red because the power goes off.
So you make it quick, and you make it something they know.
To start the 16 hours of Live Aid, would you welcome Status Quo?
Energy that day was sensational.
We were all quite nervous, actually, and not necessarily our audience, because they'd put together the whole of the bill of Live Aid before we'd been announced as being on it.
They set the level for the PA with limiters, and then when Queen came on, Tripp, who was Queen's sound engineer, switched the limiters so that Queen would be louder.
You know, from the word go, he came out of the traps like a champion.
Freddie performed against the advice of his doctor because of a throat condition. But he went out there and gave one of the greatest live television performances ever. You don't waste no time at all. Don't hear the bell, but you answer the call. Comes to you, us to us, talk. And it's time for the hammer to fall. The ballet with a BBC cameraman was shockingly charismatic. Every night, every day, a little piece of you is falling away. Lift your eyes, the Western wailing.
And it was as if all the artists backstage had heard a dog whistle, and their heads turned, and the frisson you felt was, they're stealing the show.
Defy anybody who saw it not to have goose pimples in the back of their neck when you saw that sea of people. We are the champions.
We are the champions. I remember looking up and seeing the whole place going completely bonkers in unison and thinking, oh, this is going well.
We did have an unfair advantage. We had done football stadiums. Freddie particularly learned this magical way of involving everybody in a huge football stadium. He could make everybody feel that they were in contact.
People say, was it a career move? Well, no, it wasn't a career move. But of course that's in the back of everybody's mind.
We got a great reception from the crowd, even at Wembley, and also from the TV audience as well. So, in fact, it was a great boost of confidence in a way for the group.
To have conquered Live Aid in that way undoubtedly breathed fresh energy into the band.
It was a shot in the arm. Then we went back in the studio. Of course, we were back in Munich with all its attendant dangers. So we tried to keep ourselves in the studio as much as possible. Ta-da!
I had a page, a sort of poem, that was sort of half-nicked off Martin Luther King's famous speech.
No, it doesn't fit.
Well,
One goddamn decision.
Real decision, you mean?
No, it's one fix.
It was all about one this and one that.
One gun, one soul, make one decision. Sentence, sir. Make one decision. Make two, one true religion.
Yes. One gun, one decision.